Check, mic check, mic check. Check, 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 check. Thumbs up, check. Check. There we go. New Creation Church. New Creation Church. Good morning. Are you out there this morning? You know what today is? Do you know what today is on this side? It's resurrection. Come on. Y'all got to do better than that. I'm sorry. Y'all got to do better than that. It's Resurrection Sunday. Hallelujah. It's not just any other regular Sunday of any other month. It's Resurrection Sunday. It's the Sunday that we celebrate our Savior walking out of that tomb. Getting up from that grave, conquering the grave and death. Hallelujah. So listen, I was thinking a few weeks ago, I'm going to be very brief, about the story of Abraham and Isaac, right? Now I have three sons. My oldest son, Israel, and I were in the car, and this conversation came across the radio about Abraham and Isaac. And he said, "Dad, what would you do in that situation?" And I said, "What situation?" He said, "What would you do if you were Abraham and I was Isaac?" And I said, "You know what conversation we're having right now, right?" He said, "Yes, what would you do?" I said, "Son, you know what? To be honest with you, I really don't know. I said, "What would you do?" He said, "I would do what God told me to do." Wow. So my faith needs to be more like your faith, because having this conversation with you made me really have to think about what I would do in this situation. And as you know, Abraham and Sarah had a son named Isaac, who was the son of promise, right? Abraham loved his son. Sarah probably loved her son more than Abraham did. He wasn't a child that was just a child out of happenstance. He was the promised child. They prayed and fought for him. So for God to tell him to give up that thing that you love so much for me, and that was the only reason he gave him, take your son, go crucify him, or go sacrifice him, amen? So he did just that. He put the wood on his son's back, made him walk to the site where he was to lay him down and kill him and burn him, sacrifice him with the wood that Isaac himself carried to the sacrifice. So then I thought, isn't that awesome that there's a parallel here? Because there's another father who told his son, take that wood, put it over your back, and go there so that you can be sacrificed. Now, this time it wasn't the father's job to be obedient. It was the son's alone. With Abraham and Isaac, both of them had to be obedient, right? So this son put the wood on his back and carried it through the city while they were beating him, spitting on him, whipping him, terrorizing him. And when he got to the place where he was to be sacrificed, they hung him on a cross. They pierced him in his side. They put a crown of thorns on his head. They mocked him. They spit on him. Everything they could do, they did. And guess what? He hadn't done anything to deserve that. Not one thing. Nothing. He didn't do anything to deserve that beating, the mockery, to be hanging on a cross. Do y'all know who I'm talking about now? Who are we talking about? Kids, who am I talking about? Jesus. Yell it out again.
Jesus.
Oh, we've been teaching them something. They know something about something. So on this Resurrection Sunday, let's give God some praise for his son, Jesus. Hallelujah. You gotta praise him like he really sacrificed his son so that you could have eternal life. Not just life on this earth, life on the other side. It's not even about here. It's about what he sent his son to provide for us over there. So I have one scripture. It's very few words, but very effective and very powerful. Luke 22, verse 6. Y'all know what it says? It says, he is not here. He's not here, but he's risen. Can we give God some praise for that? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So let's pray this Resurrection Sunday. We're going to do things a little bit differently than we normally do, amen, on a Sunday morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, oh God, for your son, Jesus. We thank you, oh God, for sending him to be the sacrifice, oh God, the perfect lamb to carry our sins to the cross, oh God, to bear the weight of our sin, oh God, to go through all the things that he went through, oh God, on his road to the cross, to suffer death, oh God, be buried in a tomb, and rise on the third day. God, we definitely do not take for granted what you have done, the gift that you've given us in Jesus. He was an example for us here on earth, oh God, and he died for our sins and rose again that we would have eternal life. God, and we say thank you. God, we're asking that you meet us here this morning, oh God. We're asking that your presence overtake us, oh God. We're asking, oh God, that you flood us, oh God, in this house, oh God, in houses all across the world, oh God, that you overtake services, Father. Have your way in this service. We only want to see you. We aren't here to see man. We love our children, but we aren't even here to see them. We're here to see you through them. So, Father, we submit this day to you, oh God. We submit this service to you, oh God. God, and we ask that you have your way, that your will be done. In Jesus' name, we pray, and all the saints say, amen. At this time, we have a special presentation from the children's ministry. Let's give God some praise for them. Come on, children. They knew this conversation was about Jesus this morning. That's all right. Amen.
Okay, folks, first of all, a little bit of housekeeping. When we are all done, well, first of all, for Matthew's sake, the first song we're going to sing doesn't have a track to it. So, Matthew, you don't have to worry about it. It's just on me. The second song will have a track, and he knows that one. Also, when we're all done with our songs and speeches, the kids are going to go back and sit with you. We have nobody downstairs, so they're going to be with you for the service, okay? Just so you know, all right? Okay, and the first song we're going to do is Clap Your Hands, All Ye People. Where are you, Jonathan? You're the one who keeps me straight on this. He always keeps my words straight. But is Clap Your Hands, All Ye People. Shout unto God with a joy?
Voice of triumph.
Now, when I ask the kids, how do you praise God? Do you praise him with your foot only?
No. With your whole body.
With your whole body. Oh, right. Yeah. But then why do we go ahead and raise up our hands? What's that telling God?
With our whole body.
Yeah, we're not just praising him with part of our body, but we're praising him with everything. So we give all praise and glory to God with everything we have, not just our mind and our heart, but our whole body, soul, mind, and spirit. So that's the way we're going to start. Are you guys ready? Lost it. They did it just fine, but I couldn't do that fast, so you did very well. The next song that we're going, we'll do speeches. Oops, I forgot. Yes, we have speeches now, so Miss Teresa, are you there? Okay.
The babe of Bethlehem was born so he could die. He lived and taught the crowds, but people asked the reason why. To the cross and the grave, he went so salvation's gift could be free. Now the choice is mine to make, his arms are open to me.
Thank you. It's time to praise, it's time to sing. Oh joy, he lives, the risen King.
Look, Chapter 30 says he's not here, he's rising.
Woo! Good job!
He's alive, he's a rogue.
He was delivered up for our trespasses, and he was raised for our justification.
He is risen.
God sent his son, the only one who could die on a tree to forgive you and me. Jesus is our King, our salvation to bring. Because he lives, we live.
Mark 16, after these things, he appeared in another form to two of them as they were walking into the country.
First John 5:13. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you shall have eternal life.
The Lord our Lord is coming now, so wave palms high and lowly bow. As he passes, praises sing, Hosanna, it's the King, the King. No royal robes upon him rest, he wears no gold or jeweled crown. He rides on donkey, meek and mild, Hosanna, he's arrived in town. He's come to die for all our sins and then to rise so we may live. With him in an eternal peace, Hosanna, praises to him give.
Easter is not for the bunny with goodies and treats that he brings. We must celebrate. Easter is a time we must celebrate. Hallelujah is the song that we sing.
Okay. The song of God we praise, we love. Makes the soul better and go.
Go and tell that he's alive. Go and tell his life will thrive. Go and tell that he's not here. Now there is no need to fear.
All righty, that was great. Did anybody else have one, or were you good? You're all good? Okay. All righty, the next song that we're going to sing is Praise. It's by Elevation Worship, and we really got into it. The kids were loving it, but the words are spectacular. So they'll be up on the board, so when we do the song, you'll be able to read it. And the words are so powerful because praise isn't just, yay, God. It's strength. It's a weapon to fight the fears that we have out there. So when we praise the Lord, we can praise him in the valley. We can praise him on a mountain. We can praise him when we're sure. And we can praise him when we're doubting. And this is all part of the song, so you'll see the words. We'll praise him if we're surrounded, if we are overwhelmed and surrounded. We can praise him because praise is a weapon that our enemies drown in. I mean, it sounds pretty drastic, but praise is powerful. And when you praise the Lord, I mean, when they were walking around Jericho, And they were shouting. They weren't shouting to themselves. They were shouting to the Lord. And that was praise. And that's what brought down those huge walls that were 10 feet thick all the way around Jericho. It was praise to the Lord. So you'll hear the words and you can sing with us. Now, there is one thing you have to do with us. We will do for every, gives you what for every, what is it? How does it go? Jonathan, where is it? How does it go? For every, let's pray, every, as at the very beginning. Let everything, thank you. So you'll listen to me and then you repeat it. Let everything that hath breath, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let's do it again. You guys say it with me. Let everything that has breath, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. You'll be able to do that at the end of the song.
Let's clap. One, two, hey.
Thank you.
Come on, you can do better than that. Praise God for the children. Amen. Amen. At this time, we have poetry and spoken word by Brother Siriaki. Let's give God some praise as he comes. Amen. Time for my Easter speech. Y'all ready? No, I'm joking. So this poem is, well, it's a spoken word piece. It's kind of fast, upbeat, but it's a poem I wrote about just about glory and how it definitely doesn't belong to us. So I'm just gonna jump into the piece. So I am, for those that don't know me, I am Sister First Lady Staton's brother. Pastor Marcus is my brother-in-law. And my lovely wife is over there too to support. And we are members here. Okay, so I'm just gonna jump into the poem. They say I have a way with words. Like, my poems are deep and heavy. Someone should weigh my words. Like, my metaphors hit like a ton of bricks. My big puns diet, but they still crush a lot. My nouns can go pound for pound, round for round, with any person, place, or thing, and the scale swing ounces as they ate my verbs. But I still don't think it holds any weight when they say I have a way with words. Maybe they meant I robbed the dictionary and never got caught. So somehow I got away with words. Or it was a verbal assault. And they're begging me to put my weapons down, like, please, sir, put away your words, because this world doesn't ever want them to be heard, because about 2,000 years ago, they tried their best to put away our word. But he arose from death on the day of third or the third day. However you may prefer, make heaven accessible by way of word. Then he chose me to instill in me his precious word, his infection word, gave me a passion for that blessed word. Now he ghostwrites my poems to progress his words, his impressive words on the hearts of unbelievers, just to impress his words. So saying I have a way with words is absolutely absurd. I am just a vessel, broken and mended to deliver this message that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word became flesh, submitted himself to death to save the world from death. So in the Word, that's just selfless. So saying I have a way with words is absolutely absurd. What you should say is, the Word has his way with me. But if you want to compliment me, please let that compliment be that I get my way from the Word. Or I never tried to eclipse the sun and get in the way of the word. Or on this race of life, you see me trying to do my best to relay his word. But if you ever see me and the word, please remove me and just take his word and glorify my God. Thank you. Amen. I'm not even going to attempt to try to do that. Praise God. Hallelujah. Brother Esther, if you're in the building, and you are, Brother David Esther coming with a solo. Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. go ahead and say I'm not the one, but the day will come and you will see. 'Cause I'll rise again. Song, but let's have church this morning. Jesus said, I'll rise again. Death said, Jesus said, I'll rise again. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
How'd it go? Stick to your ministry. Stick to your ministry. Stick to your ministry. Brother Esther, we thank you so much for that beautiful song. Children, we appreciate you. You did a marvelous job. Can we just give it up for our young people? I know I say this often, but I don't want our children to be validation stars. And then when they go into the world, when somebody gives them a round of applause or they tell them that they did a good job, then maybe they'll do anything just because they got a little bit of praise. They ought to be able to come to the house of God. And after all the wonderful speeches and all the wonderful songs, we ought to be able to say, thank God for you. You did an amazing job. You did a wonderful job. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are created in the image of God. You are awesome. You are awesome because God created you that way. And so, young people, I want to say you did an incredible job on today. Thank you. Thank you for being in the house of the Lord on today. You all looked wonderful. In your Easter outfits, y'all were looking marvelous today. And not only your parents, but y'all adults don't look bad yourself. You all look so great on this morning. I want to say thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being in the house of the Lord. We're going to do communion following the message. So I'm going to try not to get off track. I'm going to try to go ahead and get started because somebody, who got the yams on at the house? Somebody got that ham. Somebody been waiting to come off this fast to get some fried chicken. I'm one of them. I told my wife, Pull it on out the freezer. Season it up. I don't want you to bake it today. No. Just let it marinate overnight. Then when we get home, we're going to fire up that grease. Because I've been missing some fried chicken. But somebody, I don't know if it's green bean casserole. I don't know what you eat at your house. I don't know. Somebody got some macaroni and cheese at the house waiting. And so I don't want to keep you too long. My wife said, hurry up. Today I'd like to talk to you from the subject, the power of the empty tomb. The power of the empty tomb. Luke chapter 24, if you don't mind standing for the reading of God's word. Beginning in verse 1. But early on Sunday morning, the women, went to the tomb. Taking the spices they had prepared, they found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed with their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, "Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive?
He is not here. He is risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee? That the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would continue to be with us. You have been with us in worship. We pray that you would be with us in the word. Speak through me, Lord. There's nothing good in me, as Paul says, except for you. So allow me to speak your truth, your word on today. It's in the mighty, matchless name of Jesus we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. It's Resurrection Sunday. So today we gather to celebrate and reflect on the most significant event in human history. I would like for us to consider the significance of the empty tomb of Jesus Christ. It's that empty tomb that stands as a symbol of despair or loss, but essentially, for us as believers, as Christians, it doesn't stand for loss. A lost tomb means the person that was there, because there were grave robbers and people would steal bodies, but it wasn't that the body of Jesus had been stolen. Our Savior was risen. So the tomb that is empty, the stone that is rolled away, represents the triumph over death itself. In the gospel accounts, we read that it was the faithful women that approached the tomb. I know we often like to talk about the disciples and how they went on to be great apostles, and it's so true, but I just want to be honest about the fact that it was Peter that had denied Jesus. It was the women who had to go get Peter and say, we went to the tomb and he wasn't there, and Peter then had to come running, but it was the women that hadn't deserted Christ in his most difficult hour. It was the faithful women. And it was early on that Sunday morning, carrying the spices to anoint the body, because that was a part of the tradition to honor and respect their Savior, their beloved teacher. And they get to the tomb and they're astonished. They're bewildered. They can't believe it, because the stone is already rolled away. And not only is the stone rolled away, but it's empty. They're afraid. Maybe someone has stolen the Savior. Maybe somebody took Jesus. As we look back on the story, even our children, Elder Brian, you were asking, who are we talking about? Jesus. Even as young children, we begin to know and understand the story of Jesus, that it was Jesus who rose. But that's looking in hindsight, we think Jesus rose. No, they were confused. They did not understand what had happened. He's gone and somebody gonna pay. If an angel hadn't spoke to them, I think they would have been going to get Peter for a different reason. Peter, you know, he has some thug in him. He cutting off ears. Jesus, he was like, tell me where they at. But instead, the angel speaks to the ladies in our text. And the angels say, why are you looking for the living amongst the dead? Why are you trying to find Jesus? I mean, for me, that's a very logical question. They put him in here. He ought to be where they left him. I imagine they saw him being placed in the tomb. And he should be here. See, It was actually a very nice tomb that was purchased. It was actually a tomb for someone who was rich and who was wealthy. And considering Jesus had always been someone who was very modest, he had very modest garments. It said it didn't have a seam in it. It was almost like ready to be thrown away. It was tattered. And so all of a sudden, you got this man who has always lived poorly, all of a sudden having this magnificent tomb that he was able to be buried in. Because by now, he was claiming not just to be the poor man from before, he was claiming his rightful title as the son of the Heavenly Father. He was claiming his rightful title as the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. So as he's in this tomb, he calls on a power to essentially walk out of the tomb. The angels already know how this is going to play out, so they're asking, why are you looking for the living amongst the dead? And they can hardly understand what's going on. And let's just look and see what they say, what they continue to say. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, why are you looking for the dead amongst who is alive? He is not here. He is risen from the dead. Here, remember what he told you back in Galilee. See, God is speaking to us, and sometimes we fail to put the pieces together in terms of what God is saying to us and about us. See, Jesus had already spoken. He had already said that there will be a time where I will have to be crucified. There is a time that I will not only have to be crucified, I'm not going to be crucified just by the nice folks, but I'll be turned over to sinful men. He gave them the whole story, but they had a hard time believing it. See, unfortunately, some of us find ourselves in the similar space as the women do, is that God is speaking to us, but we have a hard time believing what God is saying. I'm gonna come to your street. Not just do we have a hard time believing what God is saying about himself, we have a hard time believing what God is saying about ourselves. We have a hard time believing that God has gifted you to be a preacher or a teacher or a home care person, a person who cares for the home. He has gifted you in amazing ways to sing before thousands or sing before a few, because it's not about the number. God has gifted you to be able to teach the word of God. He has gifted you to be able to serve. He has gifted you to be a prayer warrior. He's gifted you to be able to be a person that loves others, even in difficult times and difficult spaces. God has gifted you. But it's hard for me to see that. It's hard for me to believe that, because I can't see with my mind's eye. I can't see myself in that space. And I think one lesson that we can learn from these women is they can't believe the thing that Jesus has been teaching them and that he has been telling them. The angel is reminding them, Jesus already told you. But we find it difficult to believe because we are looking with eyes, with natural eyes, and we aren't looking with spiritual eyes. When I look out amongst this congregation, and we certainly thank you for all the visitors that are here. Thank you for all those that have leaned in online. But I just want to say that I see more than just people that came for church on Sunday. I see the house of God filled with gifts and talents and spoken word and song and teachers and preachers and people to love on people in spaces that are challenging, people to worship, intercessors, prayer warriors. I see that all across the congregation. You may have just visited today, but let me tell you, I see more than you may see in yourself, not because I'm so special, but because I try to see things through spiritual eyes. I tell you what, if we take a moment to see things through spiritual eyes, not just ourselves, but if we see others through spiritual eyes, we'll be able to be a little more patient with somebody. We'll be able to be a little more loving with somebody. We'll be able to not hold a grudge. You wonder how you'll be able to forgive for something difficult that happened to you. We'll be able to forgive if we could see them through the eyes of God. Because the eyes of God show us the truth. That even when we see people that have hurt us or wronged us, we can see that you are still a child of God. You were still created in the image of our Heavenly Father. So there's power in this open tomb because it gives us sight. It gives us sight. But not only does it give us sight, it also shows us the power of God. It shows us the power of God. We won't even talk about the fulfillment of prophecy, right? Because somebody got some macaroni and cheese at home. So we can't miss the power of God and that it triumphs darkness in this difficult space. There is a chasm between humanity and God. And no matter how hard we try, no matter how nice we are to people, our righteousness is still as a filthy rag. And unless there is a powerful sacrifice to cover the sins of every human, past, present, and future, then we can never regain atonement. Okay. What do I mean? What I'm saying is that when you get up in the morning and you pray, okay, does that... We got anybody that prays? We got anybody that pray? We got some praying folks in here. Do you like to pray in the morning or do you like to pray at night? You got some church folks in here. I got to pray all day. I need him every minute of the hour. So I want to be clear. As you are praying all day, where do you pray? See, if in the Old Testament, right, oftentimes you needed to go see somebody. You needed to go to the priest in order to get a prayer through. And so what it was in the Holy of Holies, there was a veil there. And we could not enter into the Holy of Holies. We could not go into the space where we could commune with God individually or one-on-one. We could not do that. If you went into the Holy of Holies and you were not prepared, see, the priest would have a rope tied around him because you may have had a bad thought. You may have sinned and we didn't know about it. And I tell you what I'm not going to do. I'm not coming in after you when the Lord strike you dead. So we got a rope tied to you. And if you mess around and go in there and you ain't supposed to and you ain't right, then we just going to pull you out by that rope. I'm not coming in to get you because I'm not saying I'm right. So we just going to pull you up out of there. That is the picture of the Old Testament and how we were able to communicate with God, or should I say, the lack thereof. When you wanted to make a sacrifice, you couldn't just sacrifice. In order for the sacrifice to be right, you had to take it to the priest. The priest had to get a portion of what you took. Oh, there were so many laws and rules and so many ways in which we could not get into God's presence. Oh, but something had to happen when Jesus died on the cross. He shed his blood. The thorns were sunk into his head. Oh, it was the power of God that allowed him to be slain. He said, oh, you don't understand. You think that you taking my life. You can't take my life. I give up my life. I believe that he was holding back the angels from coming. Listen, you think I'm scared of you? If I'm praying right now that my daddy don't send the angels, if I call them, all y'all gonna be in trouble. It was that power. It was that power that allowed him to raise from the dead. At some point, all the believers will rise from the dead. It says that he is the first of many who will rise from the dead. You can take a look at it. It's 1 Corinthians 15. But I'm trying to move through. Somebody got macaroni and cheese on at home. So what I'm saying is that he is the first of many. He's not the only person that will rise from the dead. At some point, God will call us all up. I said God will call us all up. At some point, God will call us all. But here's the thing. He will call us. He will empower us to be risen. Oh, but Jesus didn't need to call anybody. He didn't need to get on the phone. He didn't need to say, Lord, can you help me? He rose up all by himself. He didn't need help. It was the power of God. He didn't call on anybody. The angels came a little bit later. They knew the plan. They knew what was going on, but he was already gone. They didn't come down to help him up out the grave. The power of God allowed him to get up, allowed him to beat death down for our sake. It was the power of God. And I don't want us to just move past this point. I don't want us to not realize that if it wasn't for the power of God, he's displaying how awesome he is. Lazarus, you remember Lazarus? Lazarus died. He called Lazarus. Lazarus was not getting up without the power of God to call him forward. Jesus didn't need anybody to call him. He wasn't depending on anything. Okay. For all of those of you that can stand, for a moment, 5 seconds, for all of those of you that can stand out of your chair, can you just stand? For anybody that can stand, can you just stand? 4, 3, 2, 1. Now sit back down. Now you may find it comfortable to sit in the chair, but you're not dependent on the chair. You'll get it later. So Jesus, he allowed the grave to hold him, but he wasn't depending on the grave. When you got up out of the chair, you said, I don't need this chair. I'm using this chair because it makes me feel comfortable. But as soon as I get good and ready, as soon as this preacher get to preaching too long, I'm out of here. Jesus was powerful enough that he didn't need to be in the grave. He chose to be in the grave. He chose to be in the grave for our sake. He chose to be obedient to his Father for our sake. Because he saw that we had a need for a Savior. See, we said we got some folks that pray all the time and everywhere. He said, I got the power to get up out of this tomb because there's going to be somebody that needs to pray when the priest ain't around. There's somebody that's going to need to worship and get into the Holy of Holies. You ever had an experience with God where you got in a place which you just didn't want to leave? Lord, it's just me and you in that prayer closet, and I have no desire to go anywhere. If I could just hang out here with you all day. Oh, but the kids coming home from school, maybe somebody else can pick them up today, Lord. Can I just hang out here with you, Lord? I just want to remind you that if it wasn't for the power of God and if it wasn't for that open tomb, all of that is not possible. We have no access to God's presence if we do not have a Savior that provides a road for that access. When the earth shook and the veil was torn, impossibly from top to bottom. There's no way that it should have been able to tear. There's no way that a veil even that thick, if anything, it would have just fallen. Why would it tear? Because God was letting us know that with the death of my son, that you now have access to me. You now can come and talk to me. Anybody got some issues going on at home? Anybody got some trials and some tribulations? They got some things that they're praying about. See, you don't have to go to the pastor or the preacher. You don't have to go to anybody else. You know, because sometimes you don't want to tell all your business. I don't know about you. I may not always want to tell all my business. Oh, but you don't have to tell nobody your business. You can just go to the throne all by yourself because of the power of God. I don't have to talk to you to tell you what I'm going through. I don't have to worry about you spreading my business all over the church. I said business. I don't have to worry about you talking about me behind my back. I can go to the throne of grace because Christ died and rose with all power in his hand. Secondly, and lastly, the empty tomb says that Jesus has victory over sin and death. He's gained victory. First, right, when we talk about the power, he provided access, but not just access. He also has victory over sin and death. Victory, victory, victory. He's the champ. He's number one. He's undefeated. He's undisputed. He's the champ. He has provided victory over sin and death. See, it was his resurrection that Jesus was able to conquer sin and death to the point that he offers us eternal life. He doesn't just offer us eternal life. He offers us abundant life. He offers us freedom from condemnation. You know, when people talk about your past, because, you know, you got them three babies before you got married and now you're saved. But, you know, really, are you really saved? Because your history don't look like you're saved. Right? That attitude that you got, or we know that you know, that gambling habit you had, or them cigarettes you used to smoke. We don't talk about that at church, I understand. You know, but the things that we used to do, them extra beverages, them adult beverages, we got kids in the house, with them adult beverages that you indulge in. God says, I freed you from the condemnation of people that look down on you because of your past, because actually you are a new creature in Christ Jesus when you come to faith in this Lord and Savior that was risen from the grave. He gives us grace beyond comprehension. He loves you in a way that is really beyond our understanding. He gives us mercy beyond our what we can even fathom. And he gives us hope. The tomb, the empty tomb, is a tangible reminder that the forces of darkness and evil can never contain the light of Christ. Death couldn't hold him captive as much as it wanted to. I can imagine the enemy called up and said, Death, do we still got him in the tomb? Yes, sir, he's here. I imagine a little later on Saturday, Death, do we still got him in the tomb? Yes, sir, he's here. Late Saturday, we still got him in the tomb? Yes, sir, he's here. Oh, we got him now, Sunday morning. I'm sure he's still there. Satan calls up the death hotline. Is he still where he's supposed to be? I'm gonna lose my job. What you mean? He was here. He was here Saturday. He was here Friday. He was here Saturday. But early Sunday morning. Lord, and somehow he got out. Somehow he got up. Somehow he left the tomb empty. He somehow everybody else, I got the power over everybody else, but this Jesus character, he seems to have risen just like he said he would. He's risen just like he said he would. So my question is, what does that mean for us? What does that mean for us? That empty tomb ought to compel us, because he chose to be obedient to God and be obedient even unto death on a cross, being spit on and shamed. He chose to be obedient. He chose to love us in a way that we didn't understand. So does it compel us to love the same way? Does it compel us to obedience? Does it compel us to be bold? Does it compel us to walk in confidence, knowing that our future is secure in the hands of a risen Savior? Knowing that he has conquered sin and death. No. What does that mean for you? What does that mean for you? It means the thing that you had done once upon a time that had a hold on you that you couldn't get away from, you can now get away from it. You now can call on a Savior. You not understand it. So when he dies on the cross, we so nasty and ugly on the inside, each and every one of us. We just nasty and ugly, born in sin, shaped in iniquity. And what happens is God cannot dwell in a unclean vessel. And so it was the death on the cross. It was the blood that covers us that says, I know you're nasty, I know you're filthy, I know you smell bad, but my blood that covers you, it allows you to be clean. Now you can inhabit. Now the Holy Spirit can come in you. That's why you can go into the Holy of Holies. That's why you can pray. That's why you have power over sin. That's why you're able to speak those things that are not as though they are. That's why you have the power, and life and death is in the power of the tongue. That's why you can cast out demons. That's why you can heal. That's why you can love when it hurts. That's why you can forgive. That's why you can come together in unity with your brethren, even though it's difficult, even though I don't like her, even though I don't like him. That's why you can do it, because the power of God, the power that raised him from the grave, exists inside of you and is empowering you to do the will of God. When it says that he rose with all power in his hand, not just to do the fancy things, but the things every day that allowed you power over the sin in your life. He said, I gave it to you. I gave it to you. And as long as you dwell in me, then I will dwell in you. As long as you allow my spirit to dwell in you. And he says in Romans 8 and 39 that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing, not nothing, can separate us from the love of God. Young people, you ever go to school and don't finish your assignment? Listen. Listen, preaching is fun sometimes, okay? When you ask questions like that, they're children, so their immediate response is like, yes. But then they go into slow motion like, my mama is sitting here. I have not turned in no assignments incomplete. I love the honesty of children. Jesus did not partially cover our sins. If he had went into the grave and our sins were not fully covered, he would still be in the grave as long as it took to fulfill the assignment. He was finished when he was finished. He was done when he was done. I said what I said. On the cross, he tells us that it is finished. It's the open grave that reminds us that he rose with all power. It's the open tomb that reminds us that he rose with all power in his hands. But he was finished on the cross. But he had a date with destiny. He had a date with prophecy. He had a date with what his father had told him his assignment was. So he said, I'm going to hang out here a couple days to fulfill prophecy. But I guarantee you, your debt has been paid. So the next time somebody tries to remind you of your past, just, you know, how, when somebody tries to tell you, you know, are you did you pay the bills? My husband already took care of that. Somebody already took care of that. You can remind folks, you can remind the enemy when they try to remind you of the sin of your past. You can let them know that Jesus died on the cross and he said to me, it is finished. It is done. My sins have been hung up on the cross and they have been covered. It is finished. Your debt to sin, guess what? It is finished. Your slavery to sin, it is finished. Your past mistakes, it is finished. And now you can reign and have access to individual communion with the Father because it is finished. We are cleansed and made habitable by the Holy Spirit because it is finished. We are cleansed from all unrighteousness because it is finished. We are made to be the very righteousness of God because it is finished. We are more than conquerors because it is finished. We are a royal priesthood because it is finished. And unlike the job, unlike the business, unlike where you work, God didn't say, come on and work for me. And in 30 to 90 days, your benefits, you've been there before. Your benefits will kick in. You've been there before. Listen, I want you here. I want you here to work. You're going to do a great job, but we need to make sure that you're faithful. Sometimes they call it a probationary period. And after 30, 60, or 90 days, then your benefits will kick in. But we serve a mighty Savior. And he doesn't say, talk to HR. Because you got 30 to 90 days before them benefits kick in. No, the moment you say, Heavenly Father, I turn myself over to thee. I recognize that it was your son that died on the cross for my sins. I don't have to worry about my benefits kicking in April. I don't have to worry about my benefits kicking in March. I don't have to worry about my benefits kicking in December on the extended plan. I don't have to worry about that. I get instant benefits and all the promises of God are downloaded to me because of the blood of Jesus that covers my life. I'm so glad that it was finished when it was finished. It was done when it was done. And we can look back and see the open tomb and be reminded that it is finished. It is completed. We can walk in authority. We can walk in God's goodness. We can walk as conquerors and know that our Heavenly Father loves us enough that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. May God bless you, and may God keep you.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I got four back there. Amen. There we go. Amen. What a word from God. Let's give God a hand clap of praise. Thank Pastor Mark for his obedience. Shall we prepare for communion? If you're at home, get your elements together. While we are preparing for communion, it's just like God that he would give us a tangible example of his resurrection power. Amen. Amen. Y'all still with us? Elder James P. Moore, are you back there? If you are, raise your hand. Y'all see that hand back there? On many occasions, just months ago, they gave him days, if not hours, to live. By their estimation, he should be laid here in front of us, and we should be talking about him across this pulpit in death. But it's just like God that he decided, y'all not with me. y'all not with me. You didn't see him laying in that bed with them tubes coming out his neck. Huh? You didn't see it. You didn't see him with all those tubes all over his body. Machines breathing for him. His family praying, fasting, taking communion that this day would come. So I'm going to say it for you. God, we thank you for what you've done in this place. God, we thank you for your son, Jesus. God, and we thank you for your son, James P. Moore. Because you didn't have to bring him back, but you decided. You decided that you wanted to see him come into the house on Resurrection Sunday. Satan had his way, he'd be gone. Hallelujah. Y'all hear what? If Satan had his way, Jesus would have never gotten out of that tomb. God, we say thank you. Come on, let's give God some praise one more time. Let's move on. Hallelujah. 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 Ah, hallelujah. I'm not going to do it. I promise you I'm not. Hallelujah. 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 I'm sorry. Hallelujah. God, you didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You said yes when everybody else said no. And because you did it for him, and because you did it for Jesus, you can do it for me. There's some things that I stand in need of, oh God, like Pastor said. And I know you can do it for me because you did it for them. Amen. Let's prepare for communion. Hallelujah. Thank you for your sovereign power, oh God. Hallelujah. Is everybody ready? Father, you said in your word that as often as we do this, we do it in remembrance of you. So, God, out of obedience to you and the sacrifice of your son, we take this communion today on Resurrection Sunday, oh God. God, we thank you for all the benefits that come with it, oh God. We thank you for evidence, oh God, of your power by taking it, oh God. And we ask that you bless these elements in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. As is customary of this church, we will do our communion reading. It is call and response. Amen. So repeat after me. Thank you, Father, for your son, Jesus. By the 39 stripes that fell on my back, my body is healed from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. Every cell, every organ, every function of my body is healed and restored and renewed, I believe and I receive in Jesus' name. Eat. Hallelujah. Resurrection power is in the house. Hallelujah. Take your cup in your hand. Repeat after me. Lord Jesus, thank you for your precious blood. You are sin-free, disease-free, poverty-free. Life is in your blood. And your shed blood has removed every sin from my life. Through your blood, I am forgiven of all my sins, past, present, and future, and made completely righteous. Today, I celebrate the inheritance of the righteous, which are preservation, healing, wholeness, and provision. In Jesus' name, amen. Everybody drink. Imagine you are drinking the sin-free, mistake-free blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated for a while. It's offering time. Not right now. Oh, you're right. I'm sorry. Forgive me. While they're doing that, is there anybody who is with us that is a guest of ours today? You're here visiting this Sunday morning. If you are, we just ask that you raise your hand. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. We got hands up all over the room. Thank you all for visiting with us this morning. Our services would not be the same without you. We don't say that just because that's the thing to say. They really would not be the same without you. Amen. Now, is there anybody that's been coming for a while? Maybe it's your first time. And you feel this tug, this pull, this desire to make New Creation your church home. If you're in the house, please raise your hand. You can raise it high. We ain't gonna bite you, I promise. Praise God. Hallelujah. We give God glory for you. Welcome to the New Creation family. Both of those groups of people out these center doors, there's an information center that will be off to your right. If you could go there and grab some information. If you're visiting today, there's a bag that we would like to pick up, or that we would like for you to pick up with a card in it. Fill that card up. We just want to stay in contact with you. Amen. Is that all right? New member, you can go out to the information desk as well. We have something there for you as well. You can have a bag with an information card on it too if you've never done that. So we can get your info after service. Okay. Praise God. Are our ushers ready? I almost got jumped a minute ago. Y'all see that? No, we not. I'm sorry. It's offering time, amen. Pay yourselves as they come. Giving online, nccflint.org. You can give there. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for this day again, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for those that have to give and have those that don't have to give but have a desire to. Father, that we pray, oh God, that as we give back to you a portion of what you've given us, oh God, that you use it as you see fit, oh God, for the upbuilding of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You all can stand. Let's get ready to go home. Get to that mac and cheese Pastor was talking about. If God didn't do it, it would not have been done. So whatever you stand in need of this week, I don't know where this is coming from besides him. Whatever you stand in need of this week, seek the Father. Amen? Y'all sure? Praise God. Father, we thank you for this Resurrection Sunday, oh God. We thank you again for your son, Jesus. We can't thank you enough for sending him to die for us, oh God, that we might have eternal life. Father, we pray now that you go before us this day, oh God, that we have good fellowship with friends and family, oh God, that you take us home safely, oh God, that our meals be good, that no hurt, harm, or danger come to us, oh God, and we will meet you here again in the name of Jesus at the appointed time. All the saints said, amen. Have a great week. Happy Resurrection Sunday.